for me. It's a crocheted object, and I honestly have no clue what it is. We just can't figure it out. It's got an interesting shape. We have no idea what it is. So my two knitting and crocheting experts are going to drop by at some point. We're going to figure out what it is. Beautiful yarn. We just don't know what it is.
I say it's a lap robe.
For does somebody strangely shaped.
Strangely shaped person.
Does it move, Caroline?
Does it move? No, I have to move it. But the good news is it does not have to be walked, watered, or fed. So we're okay.
That's good.
Right. Beautiful yarn.
And if nobody can figure it out, Caroline's going to rip it apart if she decides she doesn't want it as is and make it into something beautiful.
Well, I'm going to try and make it work first. I have a theory about what it could become. So we'll see.
I was thinking last night, the center part, you could unravel from the center and it could go over your head.
Poncho, yes. Or if I unravel it from the outside, maybe it could be like a rag rug. I'm not sure. It's the largest toaster cover I've ever seen in my life. Yes. But the thing is like 5 feet long. It's hilarious.
But the yarn is very pretty.
Live on Facebook.
Yeah, I should.
It's probably something exotic, like a mangle cover, an instrument that most people don't even know what it is.
Oh my gosh, yes.
That's a possibility.
Could be. My mother had one of those and she hated it. Dad thought she was doing something really nice for it. She hated the thing.
Oh, that's funny. That's good.
Morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning, Gina. Morning, Cam.
There's Janus. Have you been busy with work, Janus?
Yeah, but I have been busy again. But and I to the office 2 days, but I'm pretty well now.
Good.
Thank you.
There's Janus and Thea.
Barely see Thea behind her roses.
I know, the roses are beautiful.
They are. Yeah.
Lost her again. Let me get her back. Yeah, there's Thea. Aren't they beautiful?
They're gorgeous.
I figured it was better the roses than my face coming and going.
No, we don't agree. No.
Dan's iPad.
No, that's beautiful.
Okay, it's now 10:30. I'm going to mute everybody.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to this edition of Napomo Community Presbyterian Church Services. As you can see, I am not Garrett. He is still down in Riverside. I think he may come back tonight, but I'm not sure. So you get stuck with me again. As far as announcements, things are kind of returning to normal this week. On Tuesday, Garrett will have his lawn chat and meeting at 10:30. The weather should allow that. Maybe a little windy, but it won't be bad. On April 14th, he will have the Bible study on Leviticus at 6 p.m. And then, of course, the lawn chat on Thursday. Sunday morning worship again next week. He will be back in the pulpit then. And on April 18th, we will have the parking lot service come forth because that will be the fourth Sunday of the month. A couple of other announcements I'd like to throw in. One session is meeting on Tuesday. So all you session members, take note of that. And the other one is a PW luncheon on the 22nd. They're going to be meeting in Pomo Park. It's a bring your lunch, bring your chair affair. There will be dessert provided. So that should be a good time for everyone. And now let's prepare ourselves for worship. We seem to have lost our sound.
Indeed.
Now, will you join me? You can unmute yourselves if you'd like to join in, or you can stay muted, but join me in our call to worship. Risen Christ. Risen Christ, where your absence leaves us paralyzed, but where your presence is overwhelming, breathe on us with abundant life. That where we cannot see, may we have the courage to believe that we will be raised with you. To you be all honor and glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
And now we come to our time of confession, a time when we can look at ourselves and come before the Lord, knowing that we have his grace and his love. So please join me in our prayer of confession. Eternal Father, raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin, which brings with it death. You have shown us how great your love for us is, and ask us to show that love to the world in which we live. Still, we live as if we are dead and have no hope in our lives. We cannot love others because we cannot love ourselves and are unsure of your love for us. Forgive us our doubts as you forgave the doubts of Thomas, and open us to receive your power as you did the disciples long ago, that we may bring your light and love into the world. In Jesus' name, amen. And now take a few moments of your own. And now let us continue, knowing that we are forgiven people, that Jesus Christ died and paid the price for our sins to set us free. As far as the east is from the west, he has taken our sins and removed them from his sight. We have hope now and can come before our Father in heaven, knowing that he loves us and accepts us just as we are. So know now that in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Now we come to the time of prayer when we offer up before the Lord our petitions and our praises. So if you have a prayer request or a praise that you would like to share, please let Jim know. He will turn your screen on and you can share it with everyone.
This is Barbara. I have a prayer request. Can you hear me?
Barb.
Our neighbor Tanya, we've been praying for her recently because she's been having a tough time. Her son hung himself over in Porterville, and she's gone over there to be with the family. So I would like to ask special prayers. I'm sorry?
He's on life support.
He's on life support right now. But he's considered brain dead. So if we could just pray for that family, they've been through a lot lately.
Hi, this is Bonnie. I'd like to pray, me and my sister are going to UCLA on Tuesday
to fill out paperwork so I can get a new liver, and I decided to pray for traveling mercies and get everything go well.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Christy?
Yes?
I would like prayer. This is for my sister-in-law. I asked for prayer for her before because she was being evaluated for possible dementia. She is going to have to be placed in a memory care facility. This is something she does not want to do. So my former husband has power of attorney for her, and he's having to deal with all of this. He's going to have to see having her placed, and it's going to be very, very difficult. You know, traumatic for him, but also for her. So I would just like prayers for her and for that whole family for that transition, and that it could go smoothly.
Tony, what's her name?
Cheryl.
Okay.
And his name is Chuck.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Thank you.
Anyone else have a prayer? It must have been a good week. So let us give praise to God for that. Lord, hear our praise. Let us go now to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you. We know that you have listened intently to the requests laid before you, as well as the requests held in our hearts and not shared with others. Father, we know that you love your children, that you do not like to see them suffer, and that you have the power to be with them and help them in this time. We lift up especially Tanya and her family as they face her son's, his passing that is imminent. Be with them and help them to understand this difficult thing that they have to face. And be with Tony's sister-in-law as she faces changes in her life due to the dementia. Lord, we know that it is very hard to change what we are familiar with, to give up what we know, and to face an uncertain future. But Lord, we ask that you will go with her. Let her know that she does not go alone, and help Chuck as he makes his decision and takes charge of the situation. Give him strength and comfort in knowing that what he is doing is the right thing. Lord, we just ask that you will be among those who suffer in this world, for there are so many and the pain is so great, but we know that your love is greater still. And hear us now as we pray the prayer that Jesus gave his disciples long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now we have some special music by Nanette and Linda. I didn't do a children's sermon for this week because I didn't think we would have children here this week with Garrett's kids being gone. So we're going to go right into the scripture. And I have two readings today from the New Reserve Standard. And the first one comes from the Book of Psalms. In Psalms 31, David has been crying out to the Lord because, as often happens with David, things aren't going too well, and he's feeling a little bit swamped and overwhelmed. And so in these verses, 14 and 15, he comes before the Lord and he places his trust in him. So hear now the word of the Lord. But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. And then from the Gospel of Luke in chapter 8, verses 22 through 25, we're going to hear about the time that Jesus went out on the boat with his disciples and they got caught in a storm. And this is the account of what happened. Hear now the word of the Lord. One day he got into a boat with his disciples and he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." So they put out, and while they were sailing, he fell asleep. a windstorm swept down on the lake, and the boat was filling with water, and they were in danger. They went to him and woke him up, shouting, "Master, Master, we are perishing." And he woke up and rebuked the wind and the raging waves, and they ceased, and there was a calm. He said to them, "Where is your faith?" They were afraid and amazed, and they said to one another, "Who then is this that he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him?" The word of the Lord. Jim, go ahead and pass this. Isn't part of it. There.
I'm going to let you go on your sermon.
Okay. Well, my sermon today comes by popular request. It is going to be, I titled it, Anchor in the Storm, an Anchor Deep, because it comes from the Lenten Bible study that we did from, it was based on the book 6 Hours One Friday by Max Lucado. And the focus was how in our storms of life, we need to anchor to the cross of Jesus and to hold on tight, and we will survive. And like Jesus asked the disciples, "Where is your faith?" We need to hold on to that faith. Now, the book starts out with a little story by Max. He said he decided he was down in Florida and decided he was going to rent a boat and take it out and go for a ride. He'd always wanted to do this, and so he set forth. And naturally, while they were out there, a hurricane blew up and the waves started getting rough, and he didn't know what to do. And he said, "I was frantically running around trying to figure out what I should do because I'd never been in a storm." And he said, "Then suddenly this man came up in a boat alongside of me. And he said, 'Son, you look like you're in trouble.' And I said, 'Yes, I don't know what to do.' And the man said, 2 things: anchor deep and hold on tight." And so he talked me through. I put the anchor down and I hooked it firmly on a rock that was below the surface. And I did just what he had said. I held on tight. And I prayed fervently, and behold, the storm passed, and we were safely floating on the water that was now calm. And he said, this made me think about life, about how all of us, we go through stormy periods when everything seems to be going wrong. Doesn't matter which way we look, there's trouble on this side, trouble on that side, and we can't really see anything but those storms. And like the disciples in the boat, we begin to see that we are being swamped, and we feel like we're going under, and we fear that the troubles are going to win and that we are going to lose. Well, this study was on what we can anchor our lives on so that we don't flounder, we don't sink, and we come out on the other side safely. Now, we look at Jesus' life and people tend to think, oh, Jesus had everything fine and dandy. He never had problems. He never had storms in his life. So what does he know about storms? But he had storms throughout his entire life. He was constantly under attack by the religious leaders. He was tempted by the devil in the desert. And finally, he faced the greatest storm that anyone had to face, and that was death on the cross. His life was not an easy life. He lived a very hard life. He suffered a lot of things that we don't think about him suffering. He has suffered everything that we suffer. He has faced everything that we face. And so we can learn. He wasn't swamped. He continued on and he was victorious. And we can learn from just how his death on the cross can help us to do the same. Well, Lucano proposes that there are three basic causes of the storms in our lives. The first one is despair. The feeling that we can't do anything about what's happening around us. The feeling that everything we do is meaningless, that we might as well not even be here. And that brings on depression. In some people, it brings on anger and they strike out in violence because they feel helpless to do anything about their situation. Despair is a great storm producer. And we've all felt despair at one time or another. We've all had that feeling that nobody appreciates what we do. Nobody, you know, cares what we do. That we're just spinning our wheels and things are racing off around us. And God says Jesus looked at the same thing. He, you know, he kept talking to the people and begging with the people to come into the kingdom of God. Most of them didn't. He faced futility. I'm sure that there were many times he looked out and said, "What am I doing here? These people don't get it." We see how many times he told the disciples, "Where is your faith?" Like he did in the boat. "Here I've been talking to you all this time, and you still don't trust in the Lord." So he was expressing his own feelings of futility at dealing with the human race. And yet he pressed on. He went on. And so we need to look at how he was able to do that so that we too can anchor ourselves when we've had these feelings of despair and futility about what's going on in the world. Well, Jesus was able to press on despite criticism and attacks on his personal being because he knew who he was. He knew that he was the Son of the Father. He knew that he was Lord of the universe, and he never lost sight of that. And we too need to be sure of who we are. We need to look at the fact that we are the children of God. We have the mighty Lord on our side. That when he made us, he had a plan in mind for each and every one of us. He had a reason for putting us here. We weren't just thrown here for no reason to flounder around in the trials and troubles of the earth. He had a reason for putting us here. And if he had a reason for us, then does it not stand that he is going to be with us in what we do? That he will help us, He will strengthen us. He will guide us. And he will bring his plan to completion, even though we might not see it. We look at poor Moses. He had the tribulation of leading the Israelites through the desert for 40 years. And yet he wasn't able to go into the promised land. But God was gracious and showed him that his work hadn't been in vain. That all the struggles and trials had been worth it. So we need, like Jesus, to anchor into that knowledge that we are the children of God, that the world may come against us, but it cannot rise over us. And that no matter how insignificant our lives may seem, they have meaning and purpose in God's eyes. And that he will use us to work his plan out in this world. So the first anchor, I think of it as the nail in the anchor, the hook that actually hooks in, is my life is not futile. Well, the second anchor point that Lucado gave was my mistakes are not fatal. And this refers to the storms that we bring upon ourselves by our sins, our slip-ups, our mistakes, but even more so from the storms that we bring into our lives by carrying guilt on our shoulders. Now, Jesus never sinned, so he didn't have to carry that load of guilt on his shoulders. But I would say that most of you here today have some guilt for something you did in the past that you just can't quite shed. Most of us have those, if only I had done, or if only I had said, that we carry around in our heads, that haunt us and eat at us and rob us of our joy. We also have the weakness of saying, God could never forgive me for what I have done. You know, what I have done is so heinous that I just know God can't forgive me. I don't deserve forgiveness. We lose sight of the fact that we are already forgiven. And we refuse to forgive ourselves. Well, Jesus felt the weight of that sin and that guilt as he hung on the cross. It was for this that he came, to reconcile all mankind to the Father. Now, the Jews, they realized that man was imperfect, that we could never live up to the law as given by God, because none of us are that good. No matter how good of a person you are, you can't live up to the basic thing of love the Lord thy God and love thy neighbor as yourself. None of us can do that. And the Jews realized that. And so they would make sacrifices annually in the temple. And they would bring a lamb, or if they were poor, they would bring a couple of doves. And the priest would consecrate them, and they would be sacrificed to pay for the people's sins. And they felt that shedding the blood of a precious life would cover what they had done, that it would pay for the damages they had done. And so they had a very complicated thing of sacrifice. Depending on what your sin was, that told what you had to sacrifice. You know, the worse your sin was, the bigger sacrifice you had to make. You had to give up something that meant something to you. You shouldn't, as the law says, you shouldn't just grab a goat on the way to the temple and turn it in to be sacrificed. No, it was supposed to be something that was important to you, important to your livelihood. Perhaps it was a pet of your children. It had to be something that cost you something to sacrifice. Well, this system didn't make things any better. The people continued to sin against the Lord and against each other. The world continued to go from bad to worse, as it does today. And God, who is perfect, he cannot look upon his people in sin. Because when he does, all he sees is the sin. All he sees is the bad and the damage to his creation and to his loved ones. And that's not what he wanted. He made his creation to give love to. We are all a part of that creation that was created in love. And he found a better way for people to be made clean of what they had done. And he sent his son to be the sacrifice. He was the perfect sacrifice. He was without sin. He was without a blemish. He went willingly to his sacrifice. They didn't have to drag him to the cross. He went of his own accord. He didn't resist arrest in the garden. He went forth. He willingly gave up his life. And one of the things, I don't know how many of you have seen the film that Mel Gibson made, but he shows Jesus being dragged up to Calvary. He's beaten, he's bruised, he's near death already at this point. And they throw him to the ground while they prepare the cross for him to get on. And normally they had to drag the criminals up onto the cross because nobody's going to voluntarily jump on and say, yes, crucify me. But he showed Jesus crawling onto the cross. They didn't have to drag him. They didn't have to force him. He didn't protest. They showed him crawling up and laying down on the cross. He was willing to be the sacrifice. So we need to remember that. We tend to forget about that, that Jesus paid a great price. He did it willingly because he loved us. He wanted us to be able to stand before God the Father and have God see us as children without our sins blocking the view. He wanted us to be free of guilt and sorrow for what we've done. And it's up to us to say, Lord, I believe you made that sacrifice for me, and I accept it. I don't deserve it, but I accept it and I thank you. Just like the thief on the cross who said to his partner who was ridiculing Jesus, he said, don't you fear God? We've committed sins. We've broken the laws and we deserve to die. We deserve to be here on these crosses. This man, he did nothing. He did nothing wrong. Then he turned to Jesus And he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He was repenting. He didn't ask for Jesus to forgive him. He didn't say, I'm sorry. No, he simply asked, remember me. And that's what we need to be able to do, to say, Jesus, remember me. I'm not perfect. I have committed sins against you and my fellow man, but I thank you that you have already forgiven those sins. The price has already been paid. Help me to do better. And so that is our second nail in the anchor of the cross, is that we need to remember that no matter how serious our sins, some are more serious than others, some we don't even know that we committed. No matter how serious, they've already been paid for. They've already been forgiven. All we need to do is to accept that forgiveness and ask the Lord to help us to do better. We don't have to carry around a load of guilt. Because, oh, you know, God, look at the mess I created. I feel so terrible. I feel terrible about something I did 10 years ago. It's long past. We are free. We are free from the power that sin has over our lives. So anchor into that. Hold on to that. Make that a part of your very thinking. Well, the third anchor that he gave us was that my death is not final. And he proposes that a lot of the storms in our lives are brought on by our fear of dying and our fear of the death of our loved ones and people who are close to us, fear of the death of our dreams, fear of the death of our pets, the death of our children and our loved ones. We spend a lot of time running away from that. We spend a lot of effort trying to avoid death. A lot of people even deny it happened. I have a brother-in-law who he absolutely refuses to go to the funerals for any family members because he doesn't want to face that they're actually gone. And what a loss. What a loss to him. Because for years afterwards, he struggles with the fact that he never made that final goodbye because he was afraid to face it. And under that is that basic fear that one day I too will be dead. I too will be gone. Everything I worked for will belong to somebody else. The works that I have done will end. And I will be forgotten. One dying person that I was with tears in their eyes, they said, I don't want to be forgotten. I don't want to end. I don't want to be forgotten. Just like the thief, they were crying out, remember me. I don't want to be forgotten. I don't want it to just end. Now, most people have comforted themselves with some vision of an afterlife. Everybody has their own picture of what it is. But the one thing the thief said that struck me is he said, remember me. Don't let this be the end. Don't let me just fade into the annals of history and not be remembered. Now, the fear of death taints a lot of things that we do. We become afraid to go out and do things. I have a friend here that she is so fearful that if she leaves this place, that she will catch some disease like COVID and she will die from it. Or she'll be in a car accident and she will die in the car accident. And she's so terrified of that, she doesn't leave the building. That has shaped her life into a living death. She foregoes a lot of the glory of being alive because she's afraid of dying. We are afraid that if we make a big change in our lives, it could bring about something that will cause the death of what we've hoped for, that what we strive for, that it will be put to an end. We all fear endings, and life is full of endings, which I have found in the last 4 years to be very true. That nothing is sure in this world. Nothing in this world is going to stay the same. Everyone is going to die. Every one of us. One day we will be on this earth no more. And it's as Christians, that shouldn't be a frightening thing. If we have lived for the Lord, we know that what we did on this earth and in this life will leave a lasting mark. It won't just blow away like sand in the wind. Our mark will be left with those we touched, those we loved, the good that we did, that we don't have to worry about that. We don't have to be afraid of that. We don't have to be afraid that the lights will just go out and that'll be the end. Because we know that there's something that waits beyond for us. Jesus died on that cross to give us eternal life. He died that we might see that life goes on, that our death on this earth is not the end, it's only the beginning of a new chapter. Now, none of us know what that chapter is going to be because nobody's ever come back to tell us what it is. But we know because Jesus rose from the grave and he said, you too shall be with me forever. You too will rise. And if we can hold on to that and not be afraid of dying, to let that fear slip away, we can live a much freer and a more joyful life. We can be open to what life offers us. We can enjoy the time that we are given, and we can make the best use of the time that is given. Now, I've shared this before with some of you, but I'm going to share it again. So if you've heard it, just tune out. But when I was 18, I had to go in for surgery, and it was a minor surgery. I was going to have a tonsillectomy. Nobody thought it was a big deal. And they took me in and put me on the table. I got the anesthesia. But sometime during the surgery, things got very black for me. It was the darkest blackness I have ever seen. There was absolutely no light whatsoever. And I was frightened. I was terrified. because I couldn't see what was happening. I couldn't see what was out there. And I was really terrified. I remember that terror that was in my heart. And then it came to me. I said, I'm dead. This is what death is. It's total nothingness, blackness, forevermore. And I was even more afraid. And then I noticed that off in the distance, there was a little tiny pinprick of light. It wasn't very big, but you could see it because it was so different from the darkness. And I began to walk. I thought, I've got to walk to the light. I've got to go to the light. And so I began in this state to walk toward the light. And as I went, the light grew bigger and bigger and bigger. And the darkness receded into the background. And eventually, all was light. And I knew that I was at the gate of heaven and that the Lord was there waiting for me. And all the fear vanished. I had total peace. I was ready to step over that threshold and go on. And then he said to me, he says, you have to go back because it's not your time. I have work for you to do. And then I was suddenly just, it was like I was sucked into a big pipe. I was just pulled back. And the light was fuzzy and I was coming to in the recovery room. Well, I told everyone, I said, I died and went to heaven. And everybody, oh, poo-poo, that was just the drugs talking. You know, you were just drugged up and having a hallucination. And I said, no, it was real. This was really real. And I told my parents and they said, oh, that's nice, honey. Yeah, right. You know, you just imagined that. It was in your imagination. Well, a few weeks later, they got the bill for my surgery. And there were charges for pints of blood, just pints upon pints of blood, and extra time in surgery. The surgery had taken longer than it was supposed to. So they went to the doctor and they asked him, why? Why are these charges on here? They shouldn't be here. I'm sure it's a mistake. And he said, well, we didn't want to tell you this because there was nothing you could do anyway, but we almost lost your daughter on the table. She began to bleed and we couldn't stop it. And we were sure that she was gone. And so we had to give her lots of blood and do extraordinary measures to bring her back. Well, I, being a smart 18-year-old, kind of sat back and said, see, I told you so. But, you know, that has had the biggest impact on my life. In that from that point on, I really lost that fear of dying. Because I knew that beyond, there was something more. I knew that beyond, Jesus waited for me. And that when the time came, he would meet me. And he would usher me personally into heaven. And, you know, I tell people here, I'm not really worried about getting sick and dying. I'm not frightened by that because I have that assurance that it's just a door I have to go through. Well, not everybody is blessed with a vision like that. But we can believe that there is light at the end of the tunnel, that our Lord is waiting for us, and that he's going to meet us at that door. And he's going to usher us personally into heaven. And we don't need to be afraid of that. We're simply going to lay aside our work here and go on to the next stage. And it's beautiful. I mean, I didn't see great visions of heaven and gems and flowers and gold and all that. All I saw was the light. But the light of the Lord was beautiful. And it's peaceful. And it's a good place to be. So if we can fix our eyes on that and wipe out being terrified of the fact that one day we're going to be dead and gone, we can live now. We can live the life that we have now. We can go forth without fear. We can trust the Lord. You know, if he's waiting for us, he's probably with us right now. We're not alone. We're not alone in this universe. There is a God in heaven. And we as Christians should be able to say that with assurance. Because we have Jesus to show us there is life after death. There is resurrection. Something glorious awaits. And we can release a lot of the storms that we create by being afraid. We can be free. And that's what Jesus wanted for us. Well, when you look at these three anchors, my life is not futile, my mistakes are not fatal, and my death is not final. They all come down to one thing. When you say, well, how can I throw that anchor out? How can I set that anchor so that I can withstand the storms that come to me? And it all boils down to that one thing. Where is your faith? You need to trust the Lord, to know that your soul is in his hands. When Jesus died on the cross, he committed his soul into God's hands. He trusted his Father to receive his spirit, his essence, the very being of him. He trusted God completely, and he went without fear. He went without regret. He went being able to say, it is finished. I did what I was sent to do. He was free. And we too can be free. So the whole essence of our study, and of course we went into this really deep in this study, but the whole essence was, we need to, like the psalmist, say, in you I put my trust, Lord. My being is in your hands. And we need to live like we believe that. So anchor deep and hang on tightly. Amen. Now, Jim, we can proceed on here.
Thank you.
For those of you who are visiting us on Zoom or Facebook and have not been a part of our church before, we welcome you. We are glad that you worshiped with us today. And if you would like to learn more about us, you may join our mailing list or contact us by phone any way you want. You can email the church. The address is here on the screen. And we would love to introduce ourselves to you and get to know you better. And now we come to our times of tithes and offering. We appreciate all of you who have remained faithful through this pandemic and continued to give to the church. We pray that the Lord will lead you to continue on. You can do a various number of ways that you can see on your screen. But the most important thing that you can offer is yourself. And now will you join me in a prayer of closing? Lord, we thank you that you have given us an anchor in the cross that we can hold on to, that we can look to you in the storms of our lives, and we can stand on those promises that you made. Amen. And now go forth into this world in strength and joy and peace, knowing that the Lord is stronger than this world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You can flip him off.
That concludes our service for this week. May God go with all of you in the week to come. And Garrett will be back.